Geotry.
Thanks, Larry, and thanks everybody for joining us tonight. Mia, go ahead and turn your camera on and so we can take this away together. So I'll start by just sharing that ever since that we opened the Your Brain exhibit at the Franklin Institute, I get tons of questions from people about the brain. I think people are curious about how our brains work, how our brains can maybe work better, or even maybe whether computers are just going to take over our brains someday. And the answer to a lot of those questions is we don't know. And that's what makes neuroscience such an exciting field, especially for students like Mia in our PACT and STEM Scholars Youth programs, who are looking at the next generation of what STEM can be. Luckily, we have scientists like Dr. Kafui Dzirasa, whose work is leading the way to finding some of these new answers. And we're honored that he's here to share some of those answers with us tonight. Mia?
Hello, my name is Mia Armstrong. When I first joined the PECS program, I always had the question in my head, like, what am I really doing here? I never thought I would fit anywhere in a science major. Over the summer, I was able to participate in an internship through STEM Scholars, where I shadowed a neurologist at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. Immediately, the experience sparked my love for science and my love for the brain, which made me have curiosity of what steps to take next. I wonder how complex the study of the brain was, and how can this help me in life? Dr. Kafui, I am so excited to have questions for him, and I know that he's a great brain science. I believe that the brain is the most complex and mysterious organ in the human body. It contains the blueprint of who we are and who we can be in the future. I am both honored and privileged to discuss the matters of the brain with Dr. Kafui.
Thanks, Mia. So before we get started, I'd like to invite everyone joining us tonight to add your thoughts and questions to the conversation. So a little bit of housekeeping, you can type in the chat to reflect on what you're hearing and share your experiences with us. And if you have a specific question for Dr. Dzirasa, click on the Q&A icon at the bottom of your screen and type your question in there so we'll see it. And now let's welcome Dr. Kafui Dzirasa.
Hey everybody, how you doing?
Hey, we're so glad to have you with us.
I'm so excited to be here, and I was so excited to hear from you, Nia, and your interests, and look forward to chatting with you and learning more about you as well.
All right. Well, let's start at the beginning of your story, and we can kind of take it from there. But, you know, we've talked a little bit about Nia's interest and what kind of sparked her interest. How early did you realize that brain science was what you wanted to study?
Yeah, so I've always been interested in science. My dad is a scientist as well. I sort of see him in the participant list. Hi, Dad. He would take us to the Air and Space Museum during summers. But for me, my real curiosity was sparked when I ended up with a personal computer and access to a personal computer. And it's the sort of thing that everybody takes for granted these days, because, you know, computers are everywhere. The best computers are in our pockets, or cell phones are awesome, right? The computers back then were nowhere near as good as the worst cell phone available now. But I was so excited to have a computer in the house, and the opportunity to sit there and code and to program and explore my curiosities really birthed my interest in science. And when most people think about computers and coding, it's sort of like the early foundations of artificial intelligence. And so for me, that just grew into a curiosity about how sort of the best computer engineered system we know of, which is the brain, how it computes and how it works and how it allows us to navigate the world from every day and selects the behaviors that we'll pursue. So for me, my curiosity about the brain grew from an initial curiosity around how this thing with electricity running through it worked.
So I see you kind of actually touched on our next question, which was, what inspired you to keep going and to further your education?
Yeah, I had no choice. No, hi, Dad. My parents were like super big on education, right? And both us challenging ourselves in classes and, you know, studying words and learning words in books, something that I thought had no utility at the time when we were memorizing words every weekend, way before we even knew what the SAT was. But so education was always, always around us. But for me, it became my own personal pursuit when I just wanted to know as much about anything that my mind attached itself to, right? So I'm a super curious person and I just want to know how things tick, right? And so I'll get like a topic in my head. And back then you had to like go to the library and like actually go through card catalogs and find, you know, the book of interest or the encyclopedia and read all about the topic. So anything I got interested in, I just all of a sudden wanted to know every single little thing about it, right? And that same curiosity has to this day driven me into a research lab where I'm with other people who are all trying to learn the most we can about any given topic, right? Whether one day it's like neuroscience or whether another day it's like computers and how we teach computers to think, machine learning, or even how to put those two things together to learn and study and understand mental illness. That curiosity also extends to my life as a psychiatrist, where I spend time listening to people's stories because I'm super curious about what make people think and tick as well.
So first, Eric wants to know what computer you actually had. So quick shout out to the old computers of the 80s and 90s.
Yeah, shout out to my dad. I was so young, I'm not sure what the computer was. The first one that I got in my moderate adulthood was an i386. So I suspect the one before that was an i286, which took all of like 10 minutes to boot. And then, you know, it had like four colors on the screen, which was super exciting, which beat the Atari, which had like two colors.
I love it. So, you know, we had a chance to chat a little bit before we started this conversation, and that you mentioned, you know, some of the challenges that you faced when you were in school, including things like just being able to pay attention. And we got a question from somebody, you know, talking about how, you know, how museums or how the Franklin Institute in particular can support neurodiverse populations. And I thought that was a really great question that maybe you could reflect on from kind of this personal viewpoint in how you developed as a scientist.
Yeah, no, it's a great, we were talking a little bit about this on the advanced call as well. So the preparatory call that we had that started about 6:30, where, you know, we were all pulled together with some students talking about differences in the way the brain works, right? So I'll orient all of you out there to this conversation. So someone asked me about challenges that I had. And I pointed out that it's really hard for me to sit still, right? To sit still and like to listen to lectures. And this has always been the case for me, right? It was the case when I was a little kid in school. It was the case in undergrad. And it was the case when I was in medical school as well, where we had like 8 or 9 hours of lectures, something that is basically my brain's kryptonite. And so I came to appreciate really early that my brain rapidly absorbs information. It just does it in a way that's very different than everybody else's. And I'll tell you, quite possibly one of the most interesting riddles that I solved in medical school is when we would get lectures around a topic called gross anatomy, right? And so during those lectures, right, we're studying all the bones, you learn all the bones in the body, how they're attached, the names of all the muscles, the nerves that flow between them, the names of all the arteries. You have to like learn all of this in lab lectures and we're in class. And it occurred to me that my brain just does not pick up information the way that they were presenting it. So I went to the library and I checked out a video. And it was a video of a guy. I remember he had a British accent. So like, I mean, at the time I thought people with British accent, that's what like super smart people sounded like. So he's a scientist with a British accent. And what he would do is he would have almost a cadaver and he would dissect it and pull things apart. And he would label the things. He'd say, this is this. And he sort of cut it, dissected it, and pulled it apart. So he basically took the body, right? The model of the body apart, muscle by muscle, nerve by nerve. And I realized that my brain absorbs an incredible amount of information in 3D, right? And so as he's pulling it apart, I know where everything is because I'm watching him pull it apart. So for me, like a perfect science exhibit is a model of like a human body in which I'm sitting there touching it, pulling the pieces apart, putting them all back on in Velcro, because that's how I learn information. And so I think a lot about that, even in how I run a research lab, that people just absorb information differently. They process it differently. Some people love to ask questions, right? And then pursue that question into the deep rabbit hole, which is also me, right? Other people love background and lectures. Other people, you know, benefit from sitting and reading or hearing people. Brains are just different. And I think a lot about our society says that there's a right way to learn and a right way to do things. But that is not necessarily true. And so I'm really grateful that there are museums around, because it was museums that inspired me, right? And it turns out, I'm like now putting it all together, I was telling them before the call that I'm obsessed with Mars these days, right? So I really want to go to Mars. And part of this clearly started in the Air and Space Museum, walking around touching like spaceships and like moon and looking at moon rocks and stuff, right? So my brain just tends to pick up information that way. And I think museums would benefit from allowing people to engage science in many different ways.
I think you really hit the nail on the head. And actually, one of the things that we've learned as a museum from having done the brain exhibit is how to apply some of that science to what we do and training other people in how to do that. So we really think about how do we engage different senses in the exhibits? How do we, you know, create some experiences that are just kind of immersive and just like get you absorbed from the emotional point of view versus some things that are kind of more problem-solving challenges. And Mia, you know, we've got a question about, you know, the classroom, and maybe you can kind of share your perspective about, you know, where museums and classrooms are different in terms of how we engage the brain.
Yeah, the question that somebody from the audience asked is that, is it true that some children are not made for the typical classroom? What do you suggest we should do as educators? My opinion on it, I don't really think it is a true classroom. Like, it's nothing, like anything could be a classroom. It matters about who the educator are and what you surround the classroom to be a classroom. So what do you think as educators is a typical classroom? And are these children made for the typical classroom?
So I'm going to answer this question, and I want to answer this question with an incredible amount of sensitivity, because I know people have navigated the world in very different ways. But I think in the last 2 years, we have realized that how we would define the typical classroom has totally transformed itself, right? When schools closed down and folks were taking classes on Zoom, right, the classroom absolutely became something new. And I think in that setting, there are some individuals who realize that the typical classroom doesn't work for them, and that the new classroom, which was taking classes on Zoom, suddenly was the best environment that they could ever imagine, while other people realized that the typical, what we would call the classic classroom, was what was best for them, and that the Zoom environment was difficult and produced an incredible amount of emotional challenges. So I think brains are just different, right? And we've seen what I would, with all sensitivities, describe as that experiment over the last 2 years in different learning styles and how that impacts people differently. In our ideal world, we would figure out how to match each person with their optimal learning style, such that they can best acquire information. Right, I think Jay Atchery said it best, right? Some people actually learn what we as neuroscientists call olfactory cues. In other words, smells. And smells become paired with things, and then like they smell something and they never forget that smell, right? Some people see something and they never forget what they see. Some people taste something and they never forget what they taste, right? And some people have emotional experiences and they never forget that emotional experience. For me, I realize when I'm excited about something, anything that I've paired with that excitement stays in forever, right? It makes me really good at things I'm excited about and really bad at things that I'm not, right? So I think the goal is to create things that pair the information with experiences that each one does what we call in neuroscience consolidating, in other words, store better. But I don't think there's a thing as a right classroom.
Yeah, Yeah, I think, you know, you touched on how all of these different senses, I think, play into how we learn and retain information. And one of the things that we've learned from neuroscience that I think informs education is really thinking about how everybody benefits from getting information through different modalities. Like, I think, you know, we often hear this perception of, you know, somebody being an auditory learner or somebody being a visual learner. But neuroscience really has taught us that thinking that you can only get information one way or another way is kind of a myth. And it's really that mix of modalities that helps us. And you know, one of our STEM scholars, Melania, was, you know, just asking about this is, you know, what more have we learned about this idea of learning styles and how much of a basis does it have in actual neuroscience?
Yeah, no, I think to your point, there's an incredible basis in neuroscience, both of learning styles, right? But also the utility of combining information coming in from certain ways, right? I mean, certainly if you think about us as human beings, part of the goal of our brains, right? And this is a broad goal, is to help us survive within the environment that we're in. So survive and thrive, right? And so our brains have to get better and better about pulling in information from the environment and then shaping the choices we make. And we as neuroscientists call that behavior, right? So information in, processing it, shaping behavior, seeing how one survives, and then updating that over and over and over again, right? And so the more sources of information that we can pull in, the better we match ourselves with the environment. And you could think of simple examples in which, you know, there's sort of a lion, or let's pick a quieter animal, right? Because the lion's all auditory. I hear the lion, I'm done, I'm out, right? But you see, like, you know, a panther I'm all on the panthers these days. So you see a panther out there and you see it and you might pick up on it because you see like something moving or you hear a tiny little rustle. What you want to do is synthesize the sort of scenery looking a little bit different, maybe some movement, and pull all of that together and combine that information to say, either I could see a little shadow or I could see something moving. There's definitely a panther there, run immediately, right? So the brain has evolved to pool information together from many different sources to come to a conclusion about how we should ultimately change our behavior. And I think that is what we want to combine with learning, things that brains have learned to do and have gotten better at doing over time.
I actually agree. And I love how you switched to the panther. I kind of like the panther.
I like that you agree. I got an internship for you and everything.
My next question was, how does the different areas of your education help you think about a problem?
Yeah, so it's very, each of the areas of my training are very different, right? And they're different at different stages. So engineers think a lot about how many things work together to do something that each of the parts can't do alone, right? And so I always like to use the example of a car. And a car has its wheels and it has a steering wheel and it has an engine that, you know, used to use gas, but the world has changed and now they're electric, right? And if you saw somebody sitting there with, you know, let's say you saw them sitting on a chair with a circular thing going like this, we would not assume that they're going anywhere, right? In fact, we all might be a little bit concerned if we saw that, right? Because they're not going anywhere because the steering wheel is not the car, right? Similarly, if we saw somebody sitting on the floor and they had these four circles around them, we would assume that they're not going anywhere because the wheels are not the car. And even if they had a combustion engine, right, and it was using up gas, we would still assume that they're not going anywhere because the engine is not the car. It's only when you put those pieces together that you get something different that you don't get when you have each part individually. So as an engineer, I think a lot about how many different things work together to cause something different than each of the parts that you have alone, right? It's the same way a computer works, right? A computer is not one of the parts. All of the parts have to come together for your monitor to turn on and for Zoom to work, right? So that's how I think about an engineer. As a doctor, I think early on in training, lots of what being a doctor was actually memorizing lots of information, right? Like lots and lots and lots and lots of information. Medicine may have changed, you know, since Google came around. If it didn't, I'd like to point out to all of the medical schools out there that there's now this wonderful thing called Google, and it's on all of our cell phones and we can pull up information. But medical school was memorizing a whole ton of information. And it occurred to me that also, learning to absorb that much information was also really useful, right? Because I started to synthesize things as I was pulling in and learning to retain a lot of information, something that I didn't do very well at when I was a kid. As medicine went along and I picked a specialty, it became psychiatry. And suddenly I started to think a lot about how human beings interact with each other, right? And how human beings come together to, in the same way that engineering, right? A lot of you have a lot of parts that together produce something different. I also started realizing human beings can come together and produce something that you could never see with one individual human being. So there's a lot of education that I got through psychiatry that helped me to think about how to run a lab and to be a leader that shows up in other spaces that I'm in. I also learned a lot about how human beings absorb information, right? And process information, and how important emotions were to how human beings interacted with each other, as well as processing information in the environment. So each of the unique areas that I entered into gave me a new perspective about how I worked, how human beings around me worked, and how the universe worked as well. And that's even before talking about my other job as a neuroscientist.
Well, you kind of set us up for that. As we start talking about your neuroscience, I wanted to start out by, you know, just reflecting on, you know, the car analogy is a great example of like how a system works together, but a car doesn't necessarily change itself over time. So what your brain does. And so one question from the audience before, as we start to get into your neuroscience, can you explain what neuroplasticity is?
Yes. So first thing I'll say is that when I was growing up, the amazing show on TV called Transformers, and the cars did change themselves over time, but that is neither here nor there, right? So your brain is just
science
amazed.
Fiction, right?
Yeah, I thought so until I saw electric cars that like, right? So who knows, we may have Transformers soon enough, right? Or maybe one of you young folks will deliver them into the world and combine it with artificial intelligence. I can only be hopeful that this is the future ahead of us. Right. So this idea of plasticity, what it means is that the brain literally changes itself as information is being stored. Right. So when you think about your computer or your hard drive, right, you might have like a magnetic film that sort of changes itself. Right. And then information is stored on that magnetic field, that magnetic film. And that's how the computer retains information over time. Right. And we don't want to say that computers learn, but, you know, your computer is constantly updating itself to prevent itself from external threats. We call these virus scanners. Right. And so something is actually from a pure physics level changing about your computer. Right. So that information is stored. The brain does the same thing. And the brain does that by changing the connections, by essentially changing its hardwiring. And that hardwiring is I'll sort of be gentle because I've got some of my neuroscience colleagues out there. So I won't go too far, but I'll say that there are connections between the cells in your brain. You have over 100 billion cells, 200 billion cells. Half of those cells make electricity, and those cells can change essentially how well they listen to each other by changing the strength of their physical connections with themselves. So every time you learn something, it has to be stored in the system, and it is stored with a change in the complicated connection between these 100 billion cells, which is trillions and trillions of connections. And that's plasticity.
So we had a question in the audience again. It was, please talk about your electrical changes in the brain and what, and that can lead to mental illness. And that also touched base on another question that I had. What is mental illness? Like, when you say mental illness, what does that consist of? What is a mental illness?
Yeah, so let's first talk about electricity, and then I'll talk about mental illness, if that is okay, right? So I think a lot about brain electricity, and I'm sure you all have probably figured out why. It's because I was obsessed with computers as a kid, right? And one of the lessons I learned really early on was that computers had electricity flowing through them. Don't ask me how I learned that lesson, but I certainly learned that lesson. The computers have electricity flowing through them, right? Which means your computer is doing something very different when it is plugged in and there's electricity flowing through it, and when it is not plugged in and electricity is not flowing through it, right? It turns out a little over 100 years ago, we figured out that while there are these cells that are hardwired in the brain, there's actually electricity flowing all through them, right? And while you know your computer uses a plug in the wall, your brain is able to do really cool things. It's able to take positive charges and negative charges and separate them and then let them flow across. And when those charges start flowing across, they generate electrical pulses. And so your brain has electricity running all through it, right? Your body, and I'm a neuroscientist, so all of my colleagues in other fields will forgive me. The entire goal of your whole body is to help your brain have electricity, right? So the goal of your lungs is to get oxygen in, because oxygen is easier to make better electricity with oxygen, right? And then the goal of your heart is to figure out how to get that oxygen to your brain. The goal of your gut is to bring in nutrients, to get those nutrients up to your brain. The whole thing is all about brain electricity. And it's so important that when human beings reach the end of their life, what goes away is brain electricity, right? So the reason you can transplant your heart, right? As long as you keep your brain alive, you can transplant your kidneys, as long as you keep your brain alive. You cannot transplant your brain, right? That's how important the brain electricity is. You can't turn your brain electricity off. So brain electricity is super important, which is why I spend so much time studying it, right? And my life course as an engineer, thinking about electricity, I just started applying those questions of electricity to the brain and studying brain electricity. All right. Now I'm going to connect that with the theme of mental illness. And as I do that, I'm going to make that transition by talking about why mental illness is so important. And I'm going to talk about it both as sort of someone who thinks globally about illness, but then also specifically and selectively somebody who thinks about mental health, mental well-being, and the mental illness, mental health of young people. Right. So as I talk about this globally, I like to normalize this for everybody by saying, if you were to think about an illness that affects the world the most profoundly, and those in public health call this disability, right? So in other words, how does an illness prevent you from living your life, from working, from meeting friends? Right? People would think that the illnesses that cause the greatest disability are things like Alzheimer's disease. That's when you get old and you lose your memory. Perhaps things like heart attacks, right? Or things like cancer, or even things like viral illnesses that cause a pandemic, right? It turns out that the illness that leads to the greatest amount of disability, in other words, the thing that affects your ability to work, to socialize, and to live your life, is depression, right? And in the category of illnesses worldwide, both in countries that are developed and when you think about developing countries, there are things like anxiety and depression and bipolar disorder, all of those are within the top 10. And the reason they cause so much disability is because, unlike Alzheimer's, which tends to happen at the end of your life, these illnesses happen early in your life and stay around throughout the course of your life. So that's why they're really important. So that's sort of my public health normalizing the presence of mental illness. Now, I want to be specific here because there's a lot of information that suggests that your generation is having a uniquely difficult time with these illnesses compared to the generation before you, right? And so I, even before I get into mental illness, I want to say, as I'm talking to young people, if you are struggling with challenges, whether you're at home or you've been deeply impacted by the last few years, there is help available to you. Feel free to reach out to any adult at the museum or teacher, or there are phone numbers you can reach, 1-800-273-TALK. And there's always somebody that you can connect with and talk to about the experiences that you're having who can help you get care that you might be having, right? There's an incredible amount of evidence that shows that you all have been uniquely impacted even going into the pandemic and the effect that that has had afterwards. So I want to make it clear that we as older people care deeply about you, and there is help and resources available. Okay, so what mental illness is, as a psychiatrist, and what we define that is something that impacts, at its core, impacts your ability to function in your work setting or in your social settings, right? Now, some might experience that as a deep set of anxiety or fear interacting with other people, or a deep sense of worry about how things will go with your life or in the world, or thoughts that maybe the world might be better off if you weren't here, or feelings like nobody cares about you. These are the type of symptoms that can go along with mental illness, right? And so that's how we as psychiatrists define those set of illnesses. And it's so hard, right? Because as you think about something like cancer, it might be something that has a change in your body that you can see on a scan, right? When you think about maybe a heart attack, you can think about measuring electricity in your heart and seeing something in your heart. The biggest challenge about mental illness, a lot of this arose from about 120 years ago, when the early psychiatrists, they were all neurologists. So I know you have had an internship in neurology, Nia. And when they wanted to understand the brain, what they would do in many cases is they would wait for someone to pass away, and then their family would donate their brain, and then they might look at their brain, right, and say, can I see something that's different about the brain of somebody who was suffering? And when they looked at those brains, in some cases, they could see changes in parts of the brain. There's a part of the brain that produces a reward chemical called dopamine, and they could see a lot of the cells, like, didn't look right. And in that case, they said, well, something's wrong with the brain. The brain looks different. Let's name this after the person who described this set of symptoms or syndrome or who discovered it. And so you have diseases like Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's disease, because people could see things different with the brain. And those things where you saw something different with the brain became neurology, right? So it's very construction of psychiatry. The construction of it was, we can't see anything different wrong with the brain. And so a lot of the stigma that people talk about with mental illness is based on that initial discovery, right? But all of this is before the chemicals that interact between brain cells were discovered. All of this is before us understanding that the brain processes electricity was discovered. All that's before that. And so while we understand the brain works in an entirely new way, there's all of this stigma that sometimes goes along with psychiatric illness because of that initial framing that, well, we can't see anything wrong with the brain, but that's sort of like looking at the computer when it's unplugged and saying, these two unplugged computers look exactly the same. Why is one not functioning correctly? And it's like, well, the computer does more than just what it does when it's off, right? So that's how we think about mental illness, right? It is the set of illnesses that impact an individual's ability to function in the world. And me as a neuroscientist, I'm trying to understand what is different about the brain, looking at new things like chemistry and electricity.
Yeah, I was just listening to what you're saying, and you touched on a really hard topic, I think, now for younger kids, because I see it as my peers grow up, especially during COVID, like depression and things that anxiety and things that just come out of nowhere. And it's like, they don't have a safe place to know, like, am I really crazy or is this really happening to me? So that right there, I really believe, like, if anybody has a problem or it is anybody, don't be afraid to speak up, because there's so many other people that's going through the same thing, especially as growing up as a young person in the city of Philadelphia.
Yeah, to build off what you're saying, there are a couple of questions in the chat that I think are all around kind of the same theme that you brought up, which is, you know, how do environmental factors shape, you know, how our brains work? So, you know, folks have raised questions, everything ranging from, you know, isolation during COVID to cell phone radiation to food. Are there any general patterns that we can think about?
Yeah, so let me, my thinking around this has transformed tremendously since getting training in psychiatry, which for me started after my engineering training and my neuroscience training, right? And and I always thought about brain electricity and how I was going to create really awesome tools to change brain electricity and chemistry as a way of treating mental illness, right? And it's still something I spend a lot of time working on. But as part of my psychiatry training, I also spend time learning about, let's say, different treatments for depression. And so I know a lot of people have thought about things like chemical imbalance for depression and medications that can help with what we classically used to call chemical imbalances. One of the earliest treatments for depression was actually putting electricity directly into the brain. This used to be called shock therapy. It's still one of the most effective treatments for depression. But I also came to learn that another entirely different group of treatments for depression, which was therapy, talk therapy. It's super effective, believe it or not, right? And what it helped me to appreciate was that people talking to other people and listening to other people also change the brain, right? So it turns out part of the environmental factors that our brains experience is other people and other human beings around us. And through that experience of seeing and watching therapy and realizing, like, when I talk, my voice is literally showing up in your brain and you have cells that are firing to match the exact pattern of my voice. And I know it's doing that, otherwise you wouldn't hear me. Right. So that's how profound environmental factors can have on our brain. So I started thinking a lot about things like exercise. Right. And I'm picking exercise. I know there are a lot of things in the chat with people suggesting different environmental potential therapeutics. I like exercise because exercise makes a lot of sense to me as a thing that is helpful, right? Exercise has been studied in animal models. It's been studied in humans as having a really beneficial effect. And I think it makes a lot of sense when one thinks about mental illness and attaching it to an organ like the brain, in which I've done in this case. And then the example I gave earlier, which was the whole body is working in conjunction with the brain, right? And so there are things that you can do to help optimize the function of your body that can certainly help your brain function better, particularly when there are incredible amount of stressors around. The other thing I think that is a really good environmental factor to think about, particularly for young people, is the importance of sleep, right? And so, you know, we spend half of our lives sleeping, and we have classically assumed that the goal of your brain is to be awake and nothing is happening when you're asleep, where we as neuroscientists now know an incredibly awesome number of things happen when you're asleep, right? And so your brain is essentially clearing out toxins. And it turns out your brain also takes information that you encountered when you were awake. It suddenly starts replaying it over again when you're asleep, and then it like stores it, right? So your brain is actually literally learning when you're asleep, right? So as an environmental factor, like, stop getting on Instagram in the middle of the night, right? It might be a really bad thing for keeping your sleep intact, right? So those are like two simple environmental things that I think could be really helpful without getting into some of the more nuanced things that are worth more degree of study.
I agree. I have a problem with getting on Instagram, especially right before I go sleep.
Yeah, no. When I used to like, I would say, well, why is my like mom complaining about going to sleep and like turning off the TV and like all these things? And then I became a neuroscientist. It's like, oh man, she was right.
I'm that mom now.
Yes. And we're all like, we will never be that person. And like, there you go.
I actually have another question. You talked about how we really can't study the brain Well, it's really insulin. That's why when the person passed on, they give you the brain so you could study. So I heard that you were doing experience with mice. So how is experiments with mice helping us knowing what's happening in humans?
Yeah, so let me answer that question two ways, right? The first way I'll answer that is the one that makes me the most excited, right? And I think it really highlights the power of taking ideas from one field and then applying it to another, right? So it turns out we've gotten better and better and better of studying the brain when it's alive, right? In fact, one of the ways I connected initially with the folks on the Franklin Institute was after the federal government launched this huge initiative called the Brain Initiative. And the goal of the Brain Initiative was actually to bring in people from other disciplines like physicists and mathematicians and chemists to learn to study the brain when it was alive and in somebody's head and working, right? And so you could think about things like magnetic resonance imaging. And what magnetic resonance imaging does, you can essentially use it in a way to see, remember I said the brain needed oxygen to function better? You can basically see the brain using up oxygen in different parts and the blood delivering more oxygen to the brain. And you can actually see this in somebody when they're awake. So all of a sudden you can get a sense, you get a picture of as people are thinking. You get a picture of different parts of their brain lighting up as they're thinking. And the next generation of tools is thinking about ways of doing more and more sophisticated measures of brain information as somebody is thinking, right? So it is, so 200 years ago, 150 years ago, when we didn't have the technologies we did now, that's how you studied the brain. But I'm so excited as all of these different fields come in that we have new tools that are being used to study the brain. And I encourage all of you as young people to like read up, look up some stuff about the Brain Initiative. It is so cool, the stuff that is being developed. And it should show you a clear path in which you can learn information in other spaces and apply it to answer the central question. In fact, I think a lot of the advancement that's going to be made in understanding the brain isn't actually going to be led by neuroscientists. It's going to be led by people in other disciplines and spaces. We, in my lab, primarily want to understand mice, right? And we want to understand how mice think and feel and behave. And some of the premise behind studying mice is that we think that they're rules to nature, right? In other words, nature has a set of rules that show up, and they show up in mice the same way they show up in monkeys and the same way they show up in lions and zebras and humans, right? We don't think mice are the same as humans, but we do think nature has a set of rules. Right. So it's why in class you can dissect an animal, maybe a mouse or maybe a fish or maybe a frog, and look at its muscles and anatomy and use some of what you learned about frog anatomy to understand human muscle tissue. Right. Because nature has a set of rules that is consistent. And so we think that there's at least some rules that are consistent between mice and humans, and mice give us a really great way of learning some of those rules in a really quick way. What we do is we take individual metal wires, each about the size of a piece of hair, and then we can put those metal wires surgically into the brains of the mice. And then they wake up from surgery, they're just fine, they don't have any pain, but then as they're running around and doing stuff, we can actually see their electricity in their brain. In other words, we can see their thoughts. And so you could see how my background in engineering allows me to now see mouse thoughts. And then my background in computer science allows me to take all of that electrical information and make sense of it, right? So now I can say, wow, this is a thought where the mouse is enjoying something. I can say, this is a thought where the mouse doesn't enjoy something, but I'm sitting behind the computer basically analyzing electrical code. Right? So that's how we can use mice. And the idea is, as we can learn what those rules are, and then these new tools of looking at the human brain come along, we can say, are those rules the same between mice and humans?
That is really fascinating. I mean, just that level of precision, you know, is something that is possible today that wasn't possible, you know, what, 10, 20 years ago.
Absolutely.
And so I think that that's a great context for another audience question, which is, what devices do you see on the horizon that can aid neurodiversity and mental health that offers us new options compared to traditional treatment?
Yeah, so I would say the most powerful device that facilitates neurodiversity to date, and this is my opinion, is a cell phone, right? There has never been individual level behavioral tracking, right? So we as scientists, I basically videotape my mice and I track what they do so I can learn about their behaviors and their patterns, right? Your cell phone is constantly monitoring that and acquiring that information. When students are old enough to drive, you'll realize that Google Maps can predict the exact amount of time that it'll take you to get somewhere. And if someone else puts in the same destination, it predicts a different amount of time, right? And the reason they're doing that is because over and over and over, they're able to predict your behavior over and over and over again, right? And if you get in social media, your phone can also predict what you're going to do because it learns a lot about you and a lot about your friends and a lot about your connections, right? And so there's a lot that when a system that you're constantly giving feedback to learns that much about you, that it can do to help and aid and support learning in different ways, right? I think as the next generation of neurotechnology comes on, right, your cell phone basically requires you to I'll use this as an engineering term, it requires you to actuate it directly, right? So you have to touch it, or you have to poke it, and then you have to look at the screen. There are going to be ways of actuating your computer, your personal computer device, more directly with your brain, right? And so you could think about if there's tools that allow you to get electrical signals out of your brain, there may be days in which you don't need to talk to your phone or to press the buttons. You can interact with it much quicker using brain information and ultimately ways of getting that information back into your brain without necessarily needing your eyes or ears, right? It turns out that these ideas that I grew up off of watching Scott, I saw someone say the Borg in the chat. So I grew up watching these ideas in Star Wars, right? And Star Wars like was so out there with all of this impossible technology as people like search the galaxy. And they had like an example was this weird device. It was this box you turn into, and then a different language comes out of the box. And it was like the universal translating device, right? And now when I travel, like my phone does this. And literally I talk into it and an entirely different language comes out, right? And then there was a guy who lost his vision. And so he had on this little visor thing, right? That took light in the outside world and sort of sent vision into his eyes. And there's this a clinical trial going on right now where people who are blind have a device that sort of changes the outside light into a new type of signal that proteins in their eyes can pick up and can create vision, right? So even like all of a sudden that's real too, right? So there are all of these things that I grew up as a kid that sound like total science fiction that are suddenly possible, not only possible in clinical trials, right? We haven't figured out time travel yet, but I'm working it out. Be patient with me.
My question that I have is, why do you think it's important for science to be more accepting with people with different lifestyles?
So this is back to the question or back to the answer that I gave around getting something better when you pull a lot of the different parts together, right? And so I think that there are lots of different aspects of science and we talk a lot about discovery, right? So there's a part of science that is seeing something that no one else has ever seen before. And sometimes that requires somebody coming up with a microscope, sometimes that comes up with a new way to look at the brain, right? So there's the discovery part. But then there's an entirely different part, which is interpretation, right? So given the same set of information, two people might make a different set of conclusions, right? They may think about how to explain that set of facts in two entirely different ways. And I like to describe this from a neuroscientist's perspective, saying what that interpretation is and where it comes from, which is our brain, right? So your brain is an organ that has some constructs that are based on your genes, right? And then it essentially changes itself and stores all this information based on your life experiences, right? So as long as a person has a different set of genes and a different set of life experiences, which even twins do, right? You have the potential to interpret the same information differently. And I think science is the better for having the broadest set of interpretations possible, because sometimes we miss things because people are interpreting the data the wrong way. And you could see plenty of examples where this has happened in science, where everybody's like, this is how it's supposed to be. And somebody's like, well, I think it's a little bit different, right? A cool example of this is people used to think when you get stomach ulcers, it was just like stress. And then someone's like, well, maybe it's bacteria in your stomach causing this. And everybody sort of like laughed at that person. And it turns out, yes, you can have bacteria in your stomach that contribute to a stomach ulcers, right? And it was sort of a different interpretation. And I think there are lots of examples in science where those different interpretations drive the whole field forward. This is why it's so important to create space in science where everybody can participate. Right? Where everybody with a different set of life experiences, with this different set of backgrounds, and with this different sort of genetic beginning can come into science as well, because the entire enterprise is better when we create space where everybody can participate and ask questions.
Can you talk a little bit about, you know, as some of your work as a Black scientist in the field, and some of the work that you've done in trying to get more underrepresented minorities involved, not just in science as a career, but also the study of neuroscience and the research that's involved?
Yeah, so I mean, I sort of framed this a second ago, right? I framed it in a way that wasn't attached to my identity, but it's also, my identity is pretty obvious, right?
And I think identity matters, right? Like, yes. We can't separate our identities from who we are as scientists.
Yeah, and so I frame this in a way of saying that our brains are our genetic makeup and all of our life experiences, and that is our identity, right? And so even if I don't use the word identity, I'm saying our identities are really important for who we are and how we interpret science, right? And I work really hard. The science, particularly in the United States, has not always been inviting to people of different backgrounds and experiences, right? And it's not just science, it's lots of areas. Some of you want to be doctors, right? If you went back 30 or 40 years ago, medical schools were like 80-90% men, right? Even though half the patients were not men, right? And half the babies being born were not men. And I think that creating spaces where everybody can come in with their experiences makes science better. And it is the job of those in science and in society to figure out how to create spaces that are more welcoming to your talent than it sometimes was to ours, right? And so this is an important responsibility that I feel and that I carry for two reasons. One, because I just want the world to be a better place, and I think we should be doing the right thing, and excluding people because of their differences just seems wrong, right? It's fundamentally wrong to who I am as a human being. But secondly, I also think science is just better. Like, I think we are hurting science by also not bringing people in, right? So for me, both of those reasons are powerful enough to work to promote change. And I think both of those reasons are really important. It's why, you know, I get asked, my favorite audiences in the world, don't tell anyone else you all, but my favorite audiences in the world, hi Adam, by the way, my favorite audiences in the world are high school students. And like, I almost never, don't tell everyone, but I almost never say no when I get asked to talk to high school students, right? Because I think that you all are so creative and you think outside the box, and I want to create spaces in science that allow you to come in as well. Whether you ultimately decide that you will work in a research lab, or whether you decide you're going to spend time inspiring other young people about science, or whether you're going to spend time convincing people that they should participate in scientific enterprises. She asked the question, about people participating more broadly in science, right? So we have differences in our genetic backgrounds and life experiences. And those things also affect how medications work, right? So as we're doing what we call clinical trials, and you know, all the scientists out there could appreciate me describing this way, clinical trials is the level of science where we feel it's safe enough to test it or do experiments on people, right? So we want to make sure that those clinical trials include people of all genetic beginnings and life experiences so that the things we come up with will work. This is why it's also important to have individuals who are able to communicate more broadly about the importance of science, because we have to help people understand why there's space for them and why it's so important for them to engage with the broader scientific enterprise.
Yeah, I actually agree. I love science. So now that I know that you have a no-no zone, I will be asking you a question.
I mean, listen, now that you've got an internship, come on through.
My last question is, what is the advice that you have for teens or kids in high school or young children that wants to study neuroscience? What part of neuroscience should they look into?
Whatever they are curious about. Right. I want you to feel very comfortable with who you are. I want you to know that you are special and that you have something really important to contribute both to the world and to the knowledge of the world around us. And because I started off by talking about space and Mars, I'll also say, and the worlds around us. Right. And I won't point you to an area or space of neuroscience because it's evolving so fast that you will probably end up doing something that doesn't exist right now. And that's my hope for the progress that we're making in neuroscience.
Well, and my hope for you all as well. No, that's such great advice. And you know, as we wrap up tonight, thank you so much for this wonderful conversation. I've had a lot of fun with you and Nia thinking about where we are now, where we're going, how it all fits together. It's so clear how both your science and your personal are the sort of inspiration and hope for so many people. For everyone who joined us this evening, I hope you'll come back for a second event with our Franklin Awards laureates, a conversation with Drew Weissman and Katie Carrico on Monday, May 2nd. They'll share the story of their challenges that they faced for decades before making the key discovery that made mRNA vaccines possible. And for more inspiration, I'll invite you to check out our new video series and our podcast that'll take you out into the cosmos, maybe to Mars, as well as the next generation of biotechnology. And you can find that all on our website at www.fi.edu. Dr. Dzirasa, thank you again for joining us tonight. We look thank forward you. To seeing you in Philadelphia in a couple of weeks to celebrate your award. And we hope to see all of you at the Franklin Institute to explore whatever makes you curious. Mia, any final words from you?
Just thank you, and it's been a blast. Like Mars, you know, trying to make a reference.
I love it.